We were looking at El Nino. We'll try to wrap up the historical climate change today, hopefully. So normal conditions, you have the trade winds. So you have already the cold sea surface temperatures, high sea level pressure off Tahiti. You have warm temperatures and lower sea level pressures in the west. So low Coriolis effect, so you have pretty strong zonal winds. So the meridional scale of zonal winds is pretty large for the Pacific compared to the Atlantic and Indian Oceans, just because it's so big and the sea surface temperature contrast is so large. And that begins to also kick up the coastal upwelling, so you will see the thermocline move, and you have the rising air, condensation, and heating. And we have always talked about the Hadley cell, but here we are looking at the so-called Pacific Walker cell. It was ultimately named after Gilbert Walker because of his seminal work. And obviously there is also wind going the other way over to the Indian Ocean and to Africa and so on, which causes subsidence. So this is subsidence, right? So you have rising air here, hit the tropopause, and then sinking air, which is the subsidence. Wherever you have sinking air, you have clear skies, nice weather, of course, cold temperatures, and so on and so forth. So if you want to develop El Nino on top of that, you basically have to weaken the trade winds, or there is also a way to set up wind anomalies here and set a Kelvin wave, what is called a Kelvin wave, and push the thermocline down. As I said, we don't know exactly what happens because each El Nino tends to look different. Almost all El Ninos are associated with wind anomalies from the west on this side, but not every wind anomaly from the west causes an El Nino. So there is some understanding missing. Nonetheless, we said if you reduce the upwelling, you reduce the sea surface temperature gradient, you weaken the upwelling, and you further reduce the temperature gradient, and you have wind response. So there is a positive feedback, which we called the Bierknes feedback. So even though this is showing total temperatures, typically we look at anomalies. So this will get anomalously cooler, and this will get anomalously warmer, and this will spread the rainfall and floods and mudslides on this side, and it'll dry up and create droughts and so on. Of course, there is a big oceanic part, because if you reduce upwelling, you're going to reduce the nutrient supply and the phytoplankton blooms. So you have a lot of fish kill, birds die, and so on and so forth. There are lots of interesting stories about islands here, which are known as guano islands. I don't know, some of you have probably read it on Wikipedia, what guano is. Yes? No? Bird shit. So way back when, there was a war between three countries here over guano, because there was like $1 billion worth of, it's a good fertilizer, so it's very valuable, has lots of phosphorus and so on. So similarly, La Nina is the opposite of El Nino, and which means the trade winds get stronger, or you can have easterly wind anomalies here. I have not gone into the details, but westerly wind anomalies would push the warm pool to the east. And just like you have easterlies and divergence, if you have westerlies, you will have convergence, right? If you're trying to push water to the west and there is divergence, it's very hard to maintain the coherence of a current. Whereas if it's a convergent current, then you will have a way to keep the current very coherent. So there is in fact a 15,000 kilometer long current here called the equatorial undercurrent and so on, which we haven't talked about. We'll come back to this a little bit, because it turns out that we mentioned the heat uptake and the response to global warming and why this region is so critical for the global warming, because we said if global warming reinforces the east-west sea surface temperature gradient, then it will have a positive feedback in the sense ocean will continue to take up more heat. But if it somehow reduces the east-west temperature gradient, then you're going to go the other way where oceans heat uptake will keep reducing, which is bad news in terms of increasing the rate of global warming. There is also a CO2 angle to it. We can imagine that the colder, deeper waters at higher pressure have more CO2. So as upwelling happens, that CO2 comes to the surface, which means the partial pressure difference between the ocean and the atmosphere will decrease. So it's literally like a Coke can. You keep the Coke can cold and closed because that keeps the pressure and solubility is higher when temperature is cooler. So if you bring this water up, then you will drive CO2 out of the ocean, just like Coke will lose the CO2 if you open the can and warm it up or expose to the atmosphere. So this region is also a big signal at interannual timescales and longer timescales for amount of CO2 that is being exchanged. These are historical records of El Niños, which you can extract by looking at corals from these regions and these regions. There are some cold water corals. Of course, there are lots of corals and the Great Barrier Reef and so on and so forth here. You can look at those and extract El Niño signals. You can also look at biological production signatures in the east and west and so on and so forth. And you can see that, approximately speaking, there may be decades where there are stronger and maybe more El Niños, and there are decades where there are fewer and weaker El Niños. But in general, there is even longer time series, and there is no evidence that El Niño has changed a lot over the Holocene. So this also means we don't know exactly what will happen under global warming. Models give different answers because models have slightly different El Niños compared to nature. So we will see that even when we do global warming, we are using models which do not reproduce everything perfectly. They're amazing, they do lots of things, but they have a little bias in a few things. So we still have to interpret the results carefully, knowing what the biases are. So this is the mean CO2 flux. Where you have cold water, high CO2 water coming up, you have CO2 going out of the ocean into the atmosphere. And there are regions where the ocean is taking up CO2, so the CO2 is going from the atmosphere into the ocean. It depends on difference in partial pressure, the wind speed, the relation that's cubic or quadratic, depending on where you are, and there is the Schmidt number, all these piston velocity and so on and so forth. So just like any turbulent exchange between ocean and atmosphere, CO2 also has a temperature dependence, wind speed dependence, partial pressure dependence, and so on.
So does it matter how much biological activity there is for sucking in carbon?
Yeah, so we will see later on that there is something called a biological pump, and there is a solubility pump, which means biology is taking CO2 and trying to sink it, or it's coming up with upwelling and where biology happens. But there is also solubility pump, which means you are moving the dissolved inorganic carbon up and down. So you are taking CO2 or HCO3 minus, CO3 minus minus. And it turns out that here, even though it's a very strong biologically productive ocean, there is so much water moving up and down that it is the solubility that dominates, where biology has a very little influence on the overall numbers. Why do you say that?
Because I was looking at a model yesterday, and of course these are a tropical region where there is no sunfall, so the sea will be warmer there, right?
What is the temperature here? Is warmer or colder? Warmer than what? Wow, so is this temperature cold compared to here? Okay, I mean, you are slightly digressing. I don't want to go there. Soluble, I don't know what you read, but solubility is dependent on temperature and pressure, right? So near the surface, obviously temperature warmer than at the deep ocean. So solubility will be higher. Also at the deep ocean, pressure is higher. Okay, so when you said solubility is higher where temperatures are warmer, I have no idea what that means. Or I don't know why this model said that.
No. Okay, we just thought that when temperature is higher, solubility will be lower, right?
Yes.
And then here we are seeing is CO2 fluxes are higher there and temperature is warmer there. How come that? That's what I was asking.
Okay, so why did I say CO2 flux is higher here? Did anybody understand what I just said?
Because a lot of water is coming up.
Yeah.
I'm not able to fix those pieces.
When water comes up, it is bringing up a lot of CO2 because CO2 is higher in the deeper water. When you upwell, you are bringing water from below. Right? So higher CO2 water is coming up. So if water comes close to the surface, then there is an exchange of AC CO2 flux. The flux depends on what? If you open a Coke can, will the CO2 go into the Coke or out of the Coke?
Out of the Coke.
Why?
So because now the pressure has decreased. We have opened the lid, so pressure has decreased.
No. So what is the main key point? Is it temperature? You open a cold Coke can, immediately CO2 begins to come out. Why? What pressure? Is a partial pressure of CO2 that matter? Partial pressure of CO2 in the air is less than partial pressure of CO2 in the Coke. That's why that partial pressure difference is going to drive a immediate flux. The wind speed and all are not so important. Just the partial pressure is dominating in this case. Here, when you bring up upwelling water, you are going to bring up high partial pressure CO2. Partial pressure of CO2 in the atmosphere is lower, plus you have winds, right?
Is there a possibility when we have a lot of CO2 in the atmosphere and the partial pressure difference takes over, like it flips, and we have more CO2 in the atmosphere than water, and we can, say, try some CO2 into this question?
Well, it's a question of, it's the difference that matters. If you are increasing CO2 and ocean is taking up more and more CO2, which is what we said already,
yeah.
Right? Ocean is taking up 90% of the heat and maybe 25% of the CO2. So the question is not whether we will reverse it. Question is the ocean becoming less efficient at taking up CO2? And where? Because remember, it's temperature, it's pressure, and it's winds, right? So it's a very complex problem. So you cannot look at this and say where solubility is high, where solubility is low. Warmer waters will have lower solubility compared to colder waters. This is a basic chemistry, right? But that means you should have a constant diffusion of CO2 from deeper ocean to the upper ocean, which happens. Same thing for oxygen. So you shouldn't confuse different. There's a dynamic exchange. This is a dynamic exchange. It's not a diffusion. Right? So,
actually, if we heat the solution, its saturation point increases. That is, its solubility increases. But if you're taking pressure and temperature together, then if you mean by colder waters.
If you heat a fluid, its solubility will increase.
Yeah.
Huh?
That's all it means to be random.
Okay, so let's not go in random directions. Basic chemistry you learn separately, use Google and Wikipedia and so on. Let's stay focused on this problem. So warm water coming up here and you are expecting evaporation and so on in this region, but there is a net dynamic effect is that ocean is actually taking up CO2 here, ocean is taking up CO2 here, but you can see that it's not here, but this is also a very data poor region, so we don't know for sure. But this front of the subtropical subpolar region is taking up CO2. So the question is, as we keep warming the oceans and keep increasing CO2 in the atmosphere, what is happening to the sources and sinks of the ocean? That's the question. It's not just, you're always imagining that global warming means everywhere heat flux is being put and ocean is just sitting there and saying, give me more heat. That's not it. That's not how it, there is dynamics. There's always winds changing, there's circulation. So you have to somehow get into your mind that circulation is changing. So it's not just like you increase CO2, so suddenly ocean will start taking up CO2 from, that's not how it works, right? So upwelling, this is a very good example of how the Earth system dynamics works. This is why we have to keep looking at it again and again. So you have to keep very basic concepts in mind. Upwelling. This is a very powerful concept. We have repeated it again and again. And we'll see that at higher latitudes, there is other mechanisms because you have no stratification. So there it's more mixing. Right? Yeah. Yes.
Yes, that's what I was asking. So there are positive fluxes near the poles that will come up and comes up right before this.
These?
Yeah.
Yeah, as I said, this is a very data poor region. So there is some data here. They would have collected it in the summer, which has a specific condition. So this is, then they take all the data, they reference it to one particular year and try to make a climatology. So this is a climatology. So there is a, so what do you expect to happen here during an El Nino, for example? Don't, again, very quick. What happens to upwelling during El Nino? I said upwelling, cold waters, huh? Which means what? Okay, good. So yeah, always go to the point. Once you start saying blah 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 blah, then you are gone. Okay? So if the profiles are then very important to look at. Photosynthesis happens near the surface. So let's say you produce 100 units of organic matter. Then there is tendency to sink, but a lot of things get eaten again. So phytoplankton will be get eaten by zooplankton. Zooplankton, it will be eaten by little fish by big fish, and so on. So almost everything, 90% or more, gets recycled within about 1 kilometer. And then what falls to the bottom is very, very negligible. And which means that if you think about this place and this place, the sinking matter will be more here than here. So if you take a sediment core here, you will get more information than you would in terms of the time resolution of the information, because more organic matter is falling each year here compared to here, because this is warm waters, very little production, and so on and so forth. So immediately you should be able to relate that to oxygen. If you have photosynthesis, then oxygen should be higher, and there is a minimum here, and this increases here. I wouldn't even dare to ask why, because we'll get some very random answers. Can anybody say why there is minimum here? That should be easy. Mumbling. Can you say louder? It's not necessarily decomposition. It is aerobic respiration, so it is being eaten, right? So decomposition is a rotting, which is slightly different, but nonetheless, aerobic, all the stuff that is there, that are here, they are heterotrophic, which means like us, they breathe in oxygen and release CO2. So we eat a lot of chicken and then we are releasing a lot of CO2. So oxygen is being consumed here, so that is oxygen minimum zone. Why is it increasing here?
Pressure.
So where?
Because there's no life to take up the oxygen.
But why should it increase? The question is, why should it increase? So yeah, but solubility increases, but unless you put more oxygen, it is not going to appear, because it doesn't say let's, it's cold, let's get, respiration is going to produce oxygen. Anyway, you have to relate this to your thermohaline circulation. This water is going to come from? Near the surface, which means it's sinking higher O2. Okay, so this is respiration and this is thermohaline circulation. Nitrate, a nutrient which is consumed by photosynthesis, so it is very low near the surface. It's recycled here or regenerated, so it is increasing here. And then along the way, it is going to decrease because it's just either sinking out with the dead bodies or there is no source for it. So this increases, this doesn't, because not because of cold temperature and solubility, because you are bringing in more CO2 from the surface. Exactly the same thing, carbon, you are going to release CO2, take up CO2 because of photosynthesis, so you are going to have low CO2. So this is on top of all the exchange that's happening. So there is an equilibration time scales of gases near the surface that's purely related to turbulent gas exchanges that will add CO2 depending on whether it's CO2 is higher in the atmosphere, lower in the ocean, and so on and so forth. And it increases here again because of the opposite of this. Respiration is going to increase CO2 and then it's going to become nearly constant. So only oxygen is different because the amount of CO2 in the ocean is not limited, whereas oxygen is. So oxygen, if it doesn't get diffused out or consumed, then it accumulates. Okay, so that signature is very clear. We have already seen Ekman divergence and upwelling. So that's what you have to remember, what happens with regions where there is upwelling. So we have open ocean upwelling here, open ocean upwelling here. We have a lot of coastal upwelling here and in these places. Wherever you have alongshore winds, Ekman divergence, and cold water coming up, you are going to bring up nutrients, because if you bring up deeper water, you are going to bring higher nutrients and higher CO2. Right? But lower oxygen. Okay? So you should be able to immediately say then, what is at this latitude here, somewhere here? ITCZ. So under the ITCZ, do you expect low oxygen or high oxygen? Okay, so here it is, the global map of chlorophyll. You can clearly see the extensive chlorophyll bloom on the equator. Also here, there are also river signatures. This is the Congo Zaire River, Amazon, Orinoco, Lake Victoria is here, lots of upwelling, open ocean upwelling, coastal upwelling, and so on and so forth. If you look at satellite data for winds, clouds, humidity, anything else, you will not see the geographic equator. What will you see? ITCZ, which is known as the energy equator or meteorological equator. Okay, energy equator in the context of moving energy, but for geographers, it is known as the meteorological equator. So this is the only quantity from space which shows the geographical equator, because that's where Ekman divergence and production is. So if you remember that 90% of the fish are caught within 200 miles of the coastal upwelling zones, then you can see why. Everywhere near the coasts, there is high chlorophyll. So the competition for light and nutrients is there. Coasts are more turbulent and less light, but there is enough nutrients that there is high productivity. We get very different dynamics here, what are called spring blooms, which is a bit complicated. I don't know if I'll go into that here, but if you are interested, we can talk about it during the question answer session. So how do the contrasts work between the oceans? If you remember now, the profiles. So profiles are also something you should just remember, like the back of your hand. I don't know, we never look at the back of our hands, but this is the expression. I don't know how my back of my hand looks. So oxygen, you expect North Atlantic and North Pacific to be this way very quickly. Who can say why? No mumbling. Taking high oxygen down, so you expect much higher oxygen all the way to the bottom. This is what inundating the rest of the world, that's why O2 is increasing with depth everywhere. Whereas North Pacific is older water, so it has similar O2 near the surface photosynthesis, but because it's older, it's got much more oxygen depleted waters in the oxygen minimum zone. I hope everybody got the terminology. This is known as the OMZ. As opposed to OMG, right? This is the oxygen minimum zone. If you go there, then you will be saying OMG, I guess. Okay, so you expect CO2 also to be very different. So it is taking down atmospheric CO2, which is now around whatever ppm. So North Atlantic is much better mixed where the deep water formation happens. This oxygen has a profile because biology is dominating at least locally here, as you were asking before. So biology has a signature and produces the oxygen minimum zone, whereas CO2 doesn't feel it. And in the Pacific Ocean, you have much more CO2 that is accumulated in older waters. The opposite on pH is obviously, the impact on pH is exactly the opposite. You have much more acidic waters in the Pacific because you have much higher CO2, whereas North Atlantic has got fairly well mixed pH all the way down. So this is very simple way. So this is how you begin to connect your circulation to your physics and your biology. We haven't done much biology yet, but you know that this is all biology, right? We haven't talked about land yet. We'll touch on it a little bit as we get into the global warming projections and so on. So looking again, don't confuse solubility, etc. There's cold water here, upwelling, CO2 coming up, and there's warm waters here, no upwelling, CO2 not coming up from below. During an El Nino, all this warm water has spilled across, and you can see ITCZ moves, so it's way here, it has moved and spread further south, it's way here, it's moved and spread further south. What we do is, we compute what is called an anomaly. Everybody knows what an anomaly is. What is an anomaly?
Deviation from expectation.
So we don't, yes, essentially, intuitively speaking, that's what it is. But when you compute this here, if you are showing an anomaly for December, that means you take about, I don't know, 30 or 40 Decembers and you make a mean December temperature and you see how December of 97 is different from the mean December you expect. And it is much warmer than the mean December you would expect, okay? Those averages of 30 Decembers will be called?
Period averages, normal conditions, non-anomalous.
Yes, it's called climatology, right? When we make climatology, again, keyword. Grandma will go to sleep by the time you use 10 different words and you say climatology, she'll wake up and go back. Okay?
The second one is also December
99. This is 96, 97, anomaly, total anomaly. Keyword?
Is the line a color gradient or just equilibrium?
The line is what?
It's a line at zero degree.
When it is. Color coding.
Part of the color map. Just
what do you think? It's just the equator. I don't know what color coding means.
Sorry, what's the difference between second and third?
What's the difference between second and third? This is the total sea surface temperature. This is the anomaly. Look at the scale. This anomaly means what? I'm asking what anomaly means. Right? This is scale is?
So it's the difference.
Okay? Anomaly means deviation from the normal. Right? This is Sita, this is Rama, and that is. Okay?
Basically, the subtraction from the mean.
From the mean. We have climatology. Okay, so somehow you guys seem to tune out at some point, and I don't know, you're thinking about aaj idli acha nahi tha. It was like sambar on the rocks. Okay, so we reconstruct temperatures here using various proxies. We've talked about corals, sediments, ice cores, tree rings, etc. And this figure is became very famous after some time as a hockey stick, which is a different paper than this one. But nonetheless, these are the anomalies from a standard period, which is typically taken as 1961 to 1990 as a general measure. And this is the spread, which means as you go in the past, you can see that different reconstructions of past temperature anomalies have different values. This one is way off compared to this one. But we already talked about medieval warming and little ice age and so on. So you can see this is generally warmer, this is generally colder here, and then we are warming again. So the uncertainty of global temperature anomalies decreases as we get closer to the present period. So you have to keep that in mind, that when you go back, you want to compare the warming in the current period against the climate anomalies in the past, right? So because we want to say what is causing this warming. And you can expect that as we go in the past, there are no direct measurements. We are deriving them from proxies. Each proxy has slightly different confidence limit, resolution, accuracy, and so on. So you have to keep that in mind. We have already talked about sunspots. And there has been some argument by some people that sunspot activity can explain global warming. This calculation has been done, and the contribution of sunspots to global warming is about less than 10%. So it does contribute, but when you do all the flux calculations, radiation calculations, and so on, it turns out that the contribution of solar activity to the warming here is about less, actually about 5% or so. Okay, that's to keep in mind. So we kind of went through the historic climate change, where we mentioned that climate change probably played a very critical role in human evolution. The key word to remember is there, East African aridification. We said in the current climate, El Nino happens every few years, and every time there's an El Nino, there is excess rainfall over East Africa. So we said 3 to 5 million years ago, during the Pleistocene-Pliocene boundary, Pacific potentially had a very flat gradient, what is referred to as permanent El Nino. And that means it would have rained a lot on East Africa all the time, unlike now. That would have given you much greener vegetation, forests. So the change from permanent El Nino to an episodic El Nino probably dried up East Africa and induced bipedalism, and then everything else evolved from there. That's the best hypothesis we have, but there are many, many papers which our Wikipedia friend is here, so he may find more things on Wikipedia. Spread of agriculture has affected CO2 and methane. And Bill Ruddiman, as I said, is one of the proponents to show that the signature of human beings started way before industrial revolution, that you can see some signature of CO2 increase and methane increase from the beginning of the Holocene and the agricultural society itself. Human history has fingerprints on climate change throughout the Holocene. We will see more of it when we look at modern history. So, in some ways, you can think of global warming as a detective work where you have found some evidence of, let's say you found a dead body, you don't have any weapon of murder, so you have to prove that it is homicide, and then you have to prove how it was done and so on. So that's essentially what you'll be doing. You'll be collecting various evidences and trying to put it together and attribute the change to human activity. Evidence of little ice age is quite extensive in the northern hemisphere, especially over Europe, but it's not, doesn't seem to have been a global event. Two theories. One from Wikipedia is that there was a meteorite crash. The other one from the books is that there was a freshwater flux onto the Jinsees. North Atlantic deep water formation was perturbed, and that probably created a hiccup in the Atlantic meridional overturning and created a rapid recooling. Unprecedented tree rings. Now we can see that from various evidences. So even though there is some uncertainty here, the uncertainty reduces quite a bit as we get closer. And the role of solar variability is not very high. It definitely played a role in the little ice age, going from the medieval warming to the little ice age, the role of volcano activities and solar sunspot cycles to reduce net forcing and create at least local warming, local cooling over Europe. Okay? So modern climate change, basically, before we go into future climate change, is to look at what is much more solid in terms of the records we have since, let's say, industrial revolution. So looking at, again, in the long-term context, sea level change, since we are talking about deglaciation and end of the last glacial maximum, every time you look at sea level change, we always split it into, we mentioned one as isostatic. What was isostatic? Anybody remember what was isostatic? That's what is being shown here. So you had bedrock had sunk here because the glaciers were sitting on top and pushing them down. Bedrock would have been rising here when this is sinking. As I said, you can think of it as a flexible. So if you push down here, this front went up. And when the ice melted, this is rising again and this is sinking again. So why is that important? Basically, if you think of a place like New Orleans, which is here, which is essentially experiencing a local sea level rise because land is sinking. Plus they mined a lot of oil and water and so on, which accelerates the sinking of land, which means relatively sea level is going up. They also have taken out all the mangroves and other natural defenses they would have had. So when a hurricane comes, there's much more water that's going to come in, right? Yes.
For example, inland, there must be like huge pile of snow on top of the rocks. Why is the background rising?
Why did we say?
At that point, it should sink, right? You just said, like, where there is a glacier, it should sink. Nearby, you can't sink.
We are talking here about the change. This is the change going from last glacial maximum to present. Right? Last glacial maximum, would there have been more glacier on Greenland or less? Okay. Realization has to sink in. So wherever there was glacier, it has melted, which means even though Greenland is glaciated now, the glacier would have been much thicker during the last glaciation. So it is relatively rising. This is not showing a scale of how many centimeters per year or anything. It's just saying that bedrock is rising and bedrock is sinking.
So the ocean floor is sinking, why this is the sea level rising?
No, this is continental bedrock.
Okay, so there are red ocean.
All the glaciers are on the land, and this is bedrock sinking. Remember we had taken out lot, to build these, you will take out a lot of water from the ocean. You would have put it back. So you would be sinking the ocean a little bit. So it's the relative, right? So this is the C14 age, and this is the change in the elevation of the beach. So you had, when your great-great-great-grandfather had beach property, the elevation of the beach was 150 meters. Sea level had dropped, so Chennai was way above. Now suddenly your grandfather is getting a new beach because water has come back. This is the relative elevation of the beach, okay? So this is another way of looking at it, relative sea level. If you go back in time from 10,000 years ago to the past, as we kept building the glaciers, you would have dropped the sea level continuously as you kept moving water from the ocean onto land, and you would have released all that water back into the ocean. So you have two components here. One, locally land rising and sinking and relative sea level changing, like the ship that is getting loaded that sinks. That is the isostatic sea level change. What is the other one?
Water being taken and reduced by some.
What is that called? Eustatic sea level change, which means it is globally. So when you release the water, it is not going to remain local. Dynamically, it will get spread everywhere. So U is in general good, like euthanasia. So eustatic means it is globally distributed sea level change. Okay? So climate modes and internal variability. As we go into understanding climate change, slowly you have to begin to now separate the natural variability from what we would call global warming, or the other keyword we will keep using is, everybody's heard this, I'm sure, what is man-made climate change referred to as? Huh? Anthropogenic. Right? So we have to separate natural variability from anthropogenic change. So when we say, okay, that's from the last chapter. When we detect a signature, let's say we say temperatures over Chennai have warmed up by 1 degree since 1890 or something. This is a signal that you've detected, it's precise, it's accurate, and you are sure it's a change, right? Now, you want to know how much of this is caused by natural causes, let's say because of solar activity change, or how much of it is because of human activities and greenhouse effect. So we'll see what is called detection and attribution. So that's what we have to do. So what is natural variability or internal variability in that sense? So given the solar forcing, anything that happens inside the climate system, we call it internal modes of variability or internal variability. So that obviously El Nino is a big one, massive amount of redistribution of energy within the system, global reorganization of precipitation, energy, etc. The monsoons, North Atlantic, we'll see other things like North Atlantic oscillation, Pacific decadal oscillation. There is also El Ninos in the Indian Ocean called the Indian Ocean dipole or zonal mode, or Atlantic has its own El Nino called the Atlantic Nino, and so on. So anything that is internally generated because of internal feedbacks, internal redistribution of energy is called internal variability. Okay? So internal variability now becomes like a noise. Global warming is a signal we are looking for, and internal variability is creating a noise that will kind of ride on top of the signal, which we are now calling the anthropogenic change or global warming. So that's what it comes down to. So there are many misinterpretations that happened along the way because we were just jumping quickly. We still do that a lot. So every time you get a cold, you think that must be because of climate change, right? Every day you need a newspaper, you think Devegowda didn't win in Hassan, climate change, right? This is very common now. So this is, if you look at the El Nino over the last 50, 60 years, there is a zero line here, which would be the baseline against which you are computing anomalies over what is called Oceanic Niño Index, which is just an average over one of these boxes. So we say when El Niño happens, there is anomalous warming here. If we take a box and average the anomalies over this region, when it is above normal, we call it El Niño. When it is below normal, we call it La Niña, right? So people looked at this and said there have been El Niños and La Niñas, strong El Niños and weak El Niños, and so on. And they compared different periods and decided that, for example, here there were few El Niños and few La Niñas. And in this period, there were several strong El Niños and potentially more El Niños than La Niñas. And people jumped up and down and said, this must be global warming, and papers got published saying there that is global warming. Then statisticians came along and said, that is total bunk because the sample size is too small to say that is detectable change in the signal. And surely enough, new period came along, and you can see that this had much more stronger El Niños. Here, El Niños appear weaker and La Niñas appear more or stronger and so on. So just to reinforce, internal variability doesn't go away. Sun is moving north-south, sun is going up and down on a daily time scale. So internal variability will keep happening. The question is global warming modulating the internal variability? So if monsoon is happening, then you want to know whether monsoon is changing because of global warming. Monsoon is not going to go away anytime soon, we hope. But how is it changing? So if you think of monsoon's length of the season and number of rainy days and intensity of rain, all of them could change. So there's some evidence that rain, amount of rain has not changed a lot. It has changed just a little. But number of rainy days has changed in such a way that when it rains, it's raining more, which typically referred to as extreme events. So you have to then show that actually these extreme event probability has increased because of global warming. That's what you will have to do. Just to introduce other modes of variability, this is called Pacific decadal oscillation. You can see that it looks somewhat like El Niño, but there is also warming and cooling way off here. El Niño is mostly focused here. So you can see that there is a, this is called an Aleutian low, there is a signature here, but the PDO looks different. And in fact, just like I said, we don't know exactly what causes El Niño to start. We don't know if there is really a mechanism here, or this is just a statistical artifact, or this is related to El Niño. Nonetheless, when you look at, you take some indicator of this region, they do an empirical orthogonal function of sea surface temperatures at low frequency, they filter it out for 8-year running mean and so on and so forth. Then you will see that over this box, there are decades where things remain positive, there are decades where they remain negative. Okay, there is also high frequency variability. And if you make correlations of that with the monsoon or droughts over US and so on, you will find some relations. So what am I saying? I'm saying that typically when we say there is a mode of variability, we often are taking data and making correlations and saying such a pattern exists. And then we begin to look for mechanisms. And we don't always find them. So this is still being looked at. There are many ideas, many hypotheses, but it's not clear that it's a fundamental mode of variability. It could be just a manifestation of El Niños and La Niñas. Okay? So you can see the similarity between them. Okay? So if you have a decade of more El Niños, then it'll look like a positive PDO. If you have a decade of more La Niñas, then it will look like a negative PDO. Right? So those are always hard to differentiate. The other thing that happens in the Atlantic is called North Atlantic Oscillation or NAO, where the pressure between Icelandic low and the Azores high kind of change. So there is north-south kind of oscillation. Here we are using the term oscillation very loosely, right? This is called southern oscillation, but if you look at it, there is no clear periodicity in it, okay? So then that means it's either a stable system that needs to be kicked, and if you kick it, it oscillates and then it damps away. It's called a damped oscillator, or it's an unstable oscillator, in which case you have to explain why periodicity is not constant. That goes back to what high-frequency forcing like weather may be playing in El Niño and so on. So we won't get into that, but nonetheless, just because it's called an oscillation doesn't mean that it has actually an oscillation. It has to the extent that there are cold periods and warm periods and so on. So the same thing for this. This is called North Atlantic Oscillation. This has serious consequences as well. If the pressure, low pressure is deeper than the high pressure, then you can do your Coriolis. So winds want to go this way and the Coriolis acts that way. And if you reduce that, the gradient, then the Coriolis changes. Remember Coriolis, we didn't actually write the expression for it, but if Coriolis parameter is F, which depends on the angle, the latitude and so on, then F times U will be the meridional and F times V will be the zonal tilt because of Coriolis, which means how strong Coriolis is depends on how fast the winds or the currents are moving. Okay, so obviously if you change the gradient, then you will change the amount of Coriolis impact. So you will change rain, snow, etc., and the cold temperatures over the Mediterranean and Northern Europe. So it is important, but again, if you look at this, it's not clear that it's really an oscillation as such. We don't know exactly what are the processes that select the scales of these various ocean and atmosphere responses. And we don't even know whether the ocean is needed. In the case of the El Niño, we said ocean is definitely needed because we have upwelling, we have positive feedback between the upwelling and the winds and the El Niño growth. For the PDO and for the NAO and so on, we don't even know if the ocean is really needed or not. You have a question or you just please? No. Who can answer her? Did we talk about La Niña?
We did.
What did we say was La Niña?
But yeah, we can't say El Niño to anti Niño or something, so we didn't answer
La Niña. You're remembering the phenology or the phraseology of things. If you are sure this is El Niño, what do you think this is?
No.
That's why I'm not asking what El Niño is. This is El Niño, what is this?
La Niña.
Okay, so yes, we said many times that is La Niña. So why are you asking again? We said when we do anomalies, when it is above normal, we call it El Niño. When it is below normal, we call it? Right? Okay, the same thing here. When it is deeper here and not as the high is not as high, then we call it the positive phase of NAO. And when it flips, we call it the negative phase of NAO. So everything has to have positive and negative, otherwise it's not an oscillation or a change, right? So to go into modern climate change, then we have to understand the context of what we are doing. Right? So this is the famous curve. Everybody has seen it. What is it called? El Niño, La Niña, NAO, PDO. Huh? This is like the poster child for global warming everywhere. You go to Gully Boy and ask him, he will tell you what it is. This is the most famous Keeling curve, right? David Charles Keeling in the 1950s, as a graduate student, his advisor Roger Revel told him, go to Hawaii and start measuring CO2. And within a few years, they realized that there was a very nice signature. What is this, up and down? Does it have a El Niño time scale, it looks like?
No, it's not.
So then, are you saying something? What is this signature?
It's saying that, yeah, it can be like variation of the seasons. It can't be El Niño or La Niña because...
What is the variation of this? What is causing the variation at seasons?
Because
so no absorption of CO2 from the atmosphere.
So this is the monsoon signature. Rainy months. Where are the rainy seasons same everywhere?
So some are broadly more sunlight, more nutritious conditions for vegetation growth.
Huh? Entire hemisphere blooms when the sun comes up. When you look at spring, all vegetation in the hemisphere begins to respond, even in the tropics. So it is the seasonal cycle, but it is just spring bloom. In fall, leaves fall off. In the tropics, not all trees lose leaves, but you can still see a lot of trees photosynthesize much less or lose the leaves. At higher latitudes, you will have almost all the trees losing their leaves. If you live in higher latitudes, in fact, it will be mostly raking leaves during the fall. So when the sun comes north, March, April, May, there's a big bloom. What should happen to carbon dioxide?
Decrease.
And when fall comes, sun goes south, leaves fall, carbon dioxide goes up. Okay? So if you remove the seasonal cycle and then take a derivative, then you will begin to see El Nino and so on and so forth. So basically, the curve is now very famous. It's constantly tracking the global level of CO2. As we said, CO2 is well mixed. It's a long residence time gas, so you can measure it at one location and it will give you a good indication of hemispheric levels of CO2. So it has a seasonal cycle, the planet's breathing, you can think of as, and then it has this trend, right? So it's constantly increasing. CO2 is pretty monotonically increasing since the 1950s. So somewhere in the late 1970s, people like Wally Broker started saying, we have a problem, that this is not good, global warming has started, and so on and so forth. So mixing and residence times are important, because if you think about methane, we said the methane has residence time of what? About 10 years, right? N2O, I forgot how long it is. CFCs also have some. Actually, some of the HFCs have residence times of 1,000 years or 2,000 years and so on and so forth. So CO2 has increased, nitrous oxide, one thing you have to remember is the units. This is parts per million, this parts per billion, this parts per billion, this parts per trillion. So you have various levels of concentrations and increasing or flattening and increasing and so on and so forth. Agricultural and dams and so on. This is refrigerants, etc. In addition to mixing ratios and residence times, we also have to think about how potent they are as greenhouse gases. Okay? CO2 is considered as, let's say, greenhouse gas with one unit of global warming effect. We'll see that this is about 200 times and this is about, I don't know, several hundred times, and this is about 25 times as powerful as CO2. So it's not just the concentration, but how powerful they are as greenhouse gases that matters. So then the other concept we have to think about is radiative forcing.
It seems that CFCs are decreasing nominally. Has the refrigerant technology changed?
What do you think? How many of you heard of what happened to CFCs and HFCs?
They have a high
I asked, do you know? If you don't know, just wait. Don't throw kitchen sink. This kitchen sink approach will get you into trouble. So ozone hole, then what happened? How many of you heard of Montreal Protocol? What is Montreal Protocol?
CFC
So there was an agreement made that CFCs were causing ozone depletion, so we should stop manufacturing ozone. So whatever manufacturing CFCs, so CFC production was banned around 1987, but obviously many countries continued to produce it, and they got replaced by HFCs, and now we know that HFCs are even worse than CFCs for global warming. So now there is a race to replace HFCs. We don't have a new technology. At that time, new technology was available, but now we don't have.
So why didn't we know it then?
Why didn't we?
That HFCs are going to be worse?
Because we focused on ozone and not global warming. So it's not bad for global warming, but it's horrible for, it's not bad for ozone, but horrible for global warming. So this is showing again the various greenhouse gases, and you can see the radiative forcing together has been increasing, which means if you look at the total amount of shortwave coming in and total amount of long wave going out, you would expect that as you increase the greenhouse effect, increase the greenhouse gases, you're going to trap more energy in the system. That's what global warming is all about. So we will see that anything that causes perturbation to this radiative forcing is what we refer to as external forcing, right? So human beings burning fossil fuels and producing radiative perturbations is external forcing. So now we have become like volcanoes and tectonics, we have become an external forcing, okay? So this is increased. This gets a little bit more complicated, as we will see later on, that if you are thinking about short wave coming in and long wave going out, you are always thinking about the balance, the emission temperature, and so on. When we make simple calculations, we assume maybe there is one layer of atmosphere which is doing the greenhouse trapping, but obviously we saw that that's not realistic. You need many layers. So the emission to space also happens from many layers. So it's not as if the energy is imbalanced. It depends on the time scale. Essentially, the system is equilibrating at different temperatures, right? So if you think about equating short wave to long wave, sigma T to the fourth, then the emission temperature changes. But when we write it, it looks as if there is one emission temperature TE. But because atmosphere is so complicated, it's emitting from various levels, which depends on what is above it. Essentially, the outgoing long wave has to escape to space, right? So if you are emitting from 1 kilometer, you have a lot of clouds and humidity above it, so it won't escape. But if you emit from 10 kilometers, then it can escape to space. So it depends on what frequency you are emitting at and so on and so forth, which we will look at later on, okay? So this is reconstruction from things like, this is a foraminifera, which keeps the calcium carbonate signature of temperature. We saw this already. So here we are, higher uncertainty in the past, but now since Industrial Revolution, the uncertainty is reduced and we are constantly increasing the temperature, but it's not monotonic, right? So you have to compare. When it comes to explaining to grandma, this is the biggest challenge. You show her CO2, it's increasing, and she might believe you that we are burning fossil fuels and increasing CO2. Then you show her this and say CO2 is causing warming. Then she will say, why? It's going up and down. What would be your answer? Committed warming. It goes up and down because of committed warming? Okay, but why is it going up? So the question is, she will say this is going up straight, but this temperature is not. So, very good. What else is affecting? We used one keyword before, right? Internal variability or natural variability. So when El Nino happens, there is actually a mini global warming. El Nino is during normal times and La Nina times, the ocean is taking up a lot of the heat. When El Nino comes, it is redistributing the heat and the ocean is releasing a lot of the heat. So if you look at an El Nino year, global mean temperature goes up by a certain amount. Okay? So when El Nino happens, you will get warming or NAO, PDO, all those things. They have the ability to store heat and release heat on various timescales. So the internal variability doesn't go away. Okay? So you will have El Niños and La Niñas and little ice age and so on. So you will always have ups and downs, but the global warming will continue to monotonically increase the global temperature. As we'll see later on, each decade has been warmer than the previous decade. So years may go up and down, but as you keep averaging, it's getting warmer and warmer. So this is showing the seasonal cycle. You can see now why CO2 up and down happens here. Okay? So greening and browning, greening and browning. This is the seasonal cycle. It's not monsoon, it's just sun going north and south, creating, and the spring bloom over the ocean as well. Upwelling also changes. This is the seasonal cycle, doesn't have explicitly El Niños because it's been averaged out. And sea surface temperatures, you can see, we have seen already the north-south migration of the entire tropics, but you can also see when upwelling happens, there are some very cute waves being set up here called the tropical instability waves and so on and so forth. Shortwave radiation, so there's obviously this is what drives the greening and the browning here, and this is the rainfall. So you can see rainfall seasonality is very different. There is no seasonality here, it rains any time of the year, only here you have the strong monsoon season. But you can also see the ITCG moving back and forth, and we'll see later on that actually ITCG does something quite complicated over here in the summer season. Okay, this is just kind of the background context over which the energy received, biological production, scales of evaporation and precipitation, etc. happen. And then on top of that, you are making this perturbation in terms of CO2 changes and so on. So anytime you think about simplistic ideas of putting heat everywhere and CO2 everywhere, you have to remember that everything happens through dynamics, and in fact thermodynamics. Thermodynamics in the atmosphere is essentially evaporation and condensation. That's the most nonlinear, complicated thing. So if you change rainfall, you will change winds, and if winds change, rainfall changes. So there is always this complex feedback. So we will see that that's kind of the complicated situation now. If you say global mean temperature has gone up by 1 degree, you can say that net evaporation and humidity change should be 7%, because we know the relation between temperature and humidity. But that will not come even remotely close to saying how much rainfall has increased. Okay, that gets very complicated, because well, the first order problem, you have to know that if you increase temperature, humidity will increase. But everybody know what is relative humidity? I think we already talked about this. What is relative humidity? The specific humidity divided by? Right? So what will happen to relative humidity with warming? Why?
Because as the temperature increases, saturation
also. Right? Both as temperature increases, saturation humidity also increases. So relative humidity doesn't necessarily increase. This 1 degree centigrade change here will give you 7% change of humidity, but relative humidity will not necessarily increase because both are going up. Right? And it's relative humidity that determines most of the things like precipitation. So it becomes very complicated, and this is a long struggle. People keep on writing papers about how extremes or rainfall should change with warming. That's a very complicated problem. Because all said and done, the one thing that human beings care most about is rain, right? So this is now showing the change in CO2 with respect to the last millennium. So we were coming out of the last glacial maximum, CO2 jumped from about 200 ppm to about 280, and then we have been increasing it super exponentially since about 1850, whatever, when the massive fossil fuel burning started. Okay, we know exactly how much fossil fuel we have burned because it's a very valuable commodity. Each unit sold is tracked very carefully. So you know how much fossil fuel CO2 we have put into the atmosphere. The other things like land clearance, so fossil fuel is here. Land clearance is often a rough estimate. So you have to know how much forest was removed, how much agricultural land has expanded, and whether agricultural land is being managed in a way that all the carbon is not being re-released after each year, and so on and so forth. Nonetheless, we have somewhat of an estimate about how much land clearance is contributing, and we'll see later on that there are also contributions from changing in ocean circulation, cement production, and so on and so forth. So right now we are at some 50 gigatons carbon per year, carbon equivalent per year in terms of the amount we release. So the time scales obviously change a lot. Fossil fuels and industry is taking out geological sources and releasing, this is a bit old now, but about, let's say, 10 gigatons of carbon per year. And the big challenge is atmospheric growth is very easy to measure. It's growing at about 4.7 plus minus 0.1. So that's more than 3%, which means it will double in about 25 to 30 years. That's fairly bad news. Land use change, you can see the uncertainty here is very small. It's quite small, but here it's almost 50%. Okay, 1.3 plus minus 0.7. Land sink is also, the uncertainty is quite high. Oceanic sink, the uncertainty is low, but actually this is only the surface part. The deep part is much, much harder. So there is an imbalance in the budget, which is referred to as the missing sink, which means if you take all the sources and all the sinks, there is some part that's not explained completely. We think it is probably because of accelerated photosynthesis, because it's called carbon fertilization. As CO2 increases, plants can more easily photosynthesize, or it's going into some swamps and wetlands and so on and so forth. Nonetheless, there is a bit of a budget imbalance.
So this land sink and ocean sink are the net flow space?
Yes. Everything here is net. Huh? What is atmospheric growth? Right, so that's why you have to link. So we are looking at these kind of figures. These are all atmospheric growths, right? We looked at, this is atmospheric growth. All these are atmospheric growths, okay? So the big challenge, of course, is that if you look at the ocean, there is about 60 or 90 gigatons going in and about, or 92 gigatons going in and 90 gigatons coming out. So there's a lot of photosynthesis and solubility uptake, and there is a lot of release because of respiration and gas exchange. So you're looking at small differences between huge numbers. Land vegetation, for example, is about 60 in and 60 out, or 62 out. So you are looking at very, very small differences between huge numbers. So the uncertainty can be fairly large. Nonetheless, you combine all of them, put them together like this. So you have cement production, which is a significant contributor, along with fossil fuel doing most of the damage. Land use change is basically deforestation, urbanization, agricultural land, and so on. And you have land, atmosphere, and oceans taking it up. This is not clearly showing the missing sink, but some figures will show you what is the missing thing. So global warming comes down to two things: tracking the carbon, how much are we producing, where it is going, and tracking the radiation imbalance. How is the net energy balance changing, right? Which means how is the global mean temperature changing plus what is the distribution of temperatures. We will see that that also is dynamically responding. Just to reiterate this point, we said this is a source because of El Nino, similar source exists here. This is a source because of very strong upwelling. These are the sinks. So now the question is, with global warming, ocean is warming, winds are changing, CO2 is increasing. How are the ocean's carbon sinks and sources changing over time? Because we have to watch it carefully. If ocean suddenly decides that it doesn't want to take up any more carbon, then the atmospheric growth rate is going to increase much more rapidly. That would be the bad news. That's why we are trying to understand what is happening. Okay, so this is just kind of a rhetorical question. So we decided in the 1980s, a couple of Nobel Prizes were given out to Paul Crutzen, Sherry Rowland, and so on for the chlorine ozone work, and thousands of tons of CFC production, and suddenly started to drop after the Montreal Agreement. The ozone is recovering to some extent, but it's not as steady as you would expect because it's still a lot of CFC in the system, very long residence times and so on. But if you compare the way Montreal Protocol was quickly agreed upon by the entire globe, and you look at the negotiations that are going on now for global warming, people are not really agreeing, right? US has not signed any treaty since 1992 Kyoto. Australia, Canada also don't sign, Russia doesn't sign. Why do you think it was so easy to agree here but not for global warming? They want what?
Warming, like you were talking about the North Sea beaches and all.
Yeah. And what happened here? Ozone, you're approximately on the right track. Ozone is bad news for everybody. Nobody was going to benefit from ozone loss. Everybody is going to get harmed. Whereas with global warming, it's not at all clear that everybody will get harmed. There will be many people who will benefit from global warming, right? So many Arctic ice disappearance will not be a bad news for everybody. Siberia getting warmer will not be bad news for Russia and so on and so forth. So methane sources, we talked about methane increasing. There are some signatures in methane and CO2 that are not always related to what human beings are doing in terms of the good. For example, CO2 emissions suddenly flatten when there is a big recession. When global recession happens, global incomes go down, people drive less, productivity goes down, and you can actually see a flattening of CO2. Okay? So methane has lots of natural sources, wetlands, termites, and our friends, cows, which don't tell BJP, and of course, rice fields. So these are huge emitters of methane. But again, to remember, methane is in trace quantities, but increasing. It's more than doubled since Industrial Revolution, and it matters. Even though its residence time is only 10 years, its global warming potential is 25 times the CO2. So that's a big challenge. N2O also has a massive CO2 global warming potential. Again, it's also in parts per billion, but almost an order of magnitude smaller. So it's 1800. This is in the 300s, but still it's increasing in the northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere, and globally. Not good news. It's a very strong greenhouse gas. So just to look at it again, we talked about this many times. So we have jumped the CO2 and methane quite a bit. We are waiting for the temperature to catch up. What else is happening with human activity, we can stop with this one or another one or two, is that we are also changing land. So by deforesting with industrial activity and emissions and all the driving, we are increasing gases and also particulate matter in the atmosphere, right? If you go to Delhi, now you know that Delhi is become dangerously bad. In fact, in Delhi, it doesn't matter whether you are a smoker or not. It's as if you are smoking a pack of cigarettes per day. It's how bad the air is. The same with Beijing. Beijing is trying to improve, but it's still pretty bad. So you can see the sources and sinks of aerosols and biomass burning and dust sources from Sahara and industrial activities from China and India, agricultural activity, and so on. There are some very, very, very nice global simulations with very high resolution models. And this is the TOMS, it's ozone mapping satellite data, and so on and so forth. So when it comes to aerosols, basically, we won't discuss much other than that. When we do radiation balance, we will see that aerosols have maybe a cooling effect because they scatter sunlight and reduce the incoming solar radiation. But when it comes to aerosols, we'll look at what is called direct effect, which is the reflection of sunlight and scattering of sunlight, and also what is called indirect effect. I think you can guess what would be the indirect effect. What would be indirect? Right, so anything it does to cloud microphysics or circulation, hurricanes, all kind of theories now, is called indirect effect. So they are basically they act as cloud condensation nuclei, or what is referred to as CCNs. So if you increase cloud condensation nuclei, the question originally was whether they increase the rain or decrease the rain. More and more, it seems like they decrease the rain, because if you increase the number of cloud condensation nuclei, raindrops don't grow as big. So it drizzles. Instead of raining, it will just drizzle. So all evidences seem to point right now. This is still very active field, so people doing more and more simulations. But in the models, it's a problem because models do not do molecular scale things very well. So they have to parameterize condensation, cloud condensation, nuclei, and aerosol effects in some way. So obviously it's uncertainties associated with that, and so on and so forth. Nonetheless, you have to keep in mind that the impact of human beings is not just greenhouse gases, but also it is through aerosols, and also putting a lot of dust and dirt into glaciers and so on. This is now very clear over the Himalayas that the traffic in some places in the Himalayas is increasing the amount of carbon in the snow and ice, which accelerates the melting because of albedo changes and the heat capacity changes and so on and so forth. Okay, so we will leave it here and come back to this radiative forcing on Monday. And today's Friday, right? Yeah. So we will look at what is very well known, what are uncertain, and you can see the aerosols here already. So this is what it comes down to try to account for every activity we are doing and trying to see how they are changing the radiative balance of Earth. This is carbon counting, radiative effects, and then how precipitation is changing. It basically comes down to these three major points when you think about global warming. And then when you want to make projections, it gets tremendously much more complicated. So we'll look at some of those complications. Okay? Question period, yes? No?